Welcome to Smart Catalyst Jan 10, 2019. So today we are going to see all these articles. The first one is Tehran proposes a new regional forum for West Asia. And the second one is Free Indo-Pacific, not against China. And the third one is tokenization may aid safe digital transactions. And the fourth one is NCDC model for cooperatives as modern banking unit. And the fifth one is Gangajal project. And the sixth one is private consumption, a $6 trillion opportunity. And the seventh one is World Bank pegs India's GDP growth at 7.3% for the year 2018 to 19. And the last one is green highway takes hit as saplings disappear. So the first article is Tehran proposes a new regional forum for West Asia. So what the news here is, the foreign minister of Iran proposed an inclusive and integrated security model for the Middle East in order to meet the needs of all the regional countries, stressing that the previous alliances as well as the coalitions formed among certain countries have proved to be inefficient. So what the news here is, the foreign minister of Iran actually proposed to form a regional forum which is known as Persian Gulf Regional Dialogue Forum. Okay. So why such kind of forum? In the sense, in the wake of continued erosion of the Gulf Cooperation Council because of the conflict between Iran and Saudi Arabia. So in order to tackle the erosion of the Gulf Cooperation Council, now they propose this Persian Gulf Forum. And also they plan to offer membership to these countries based on a set of general principles to address the real issues which is actually affecting the people of that region as well as the people of the entire world. And in order to deal with the threats like terrorism and the extremism which is very much prevalent in the West Asian region, and in order to bring the peace and the prosperity in that region. So now we have to understand actually what kind of issues are prevailing over that West Asian region means. So we all knew that the Persian Gulf region has experienced the most bitter and the destructive crisis in the past four decades, and they also engaging in bloc formation and alliances which have proven that they are not that much effective. So what are the issues in the West Asian region means, the internal security situation in Syria, Iraq as well as in Yemen. So they has gone bad, and they even has gone from bad to worse, and the regional powers continue to fight for proxy wars on sectarian lines and pumping huge amount of money and weapons to bolster their favored groups, as well as not only among themselves but the involvement of extra regional players like the US as well as the Russia in the internal conflict of the West Asia has further aggravated the situation. As well as this Gulf Cooperation Council and Iran's rivalry and the Shia-Sunni conflict and external intervention in the region and the fear of rise of religious radicalism, etc., has further contributed to the instability in the West Asian region. And apart from all these things, the terrorism is also has emerged as the biggest security threat to that region. So in order to handle all these things only, now the foreign minister of Iran has proposed this Persian Gulf Dialogue Forum. So this actually has generally recognized principles and shared objectives of all the countries, notably it respecting their sovereignty, territorial integrity, as well as the political independence of the all the West Asian countries. So the second article is Free Indo-Pacific, not against China. So it is said by the US admiral. So what the news here is, acknowledging that the rapid expansion of the Chinese Navy in the, especially in the Indian Ocean region, the Quad countries now stressed on improving the interoperability, and as well as it evolves a common maritime awareness picture among the Quad countries. So what are those Quad countries means? They are India, Australia and US and Japan. So now these four countries are trying to make one common maritime awareness picture in order to tackle the Chinese Navy dominance in the Indian Ocean region. So usually this Quad country grouping is seen as a counter to China's expansion, but now they are attributing this only to the maritime awareness picture and not attributing this kind of grouping any military angle. So for this common maritime awareness picture, what they are telling is free and open Indo-Pacific is not a containment strategy for China, rather it is just want to make peace and prosperity and free Indo-Pacific region. Okay, and all the Quad countries as well as the France have expressed their interest in this common maritime awareness picture among the Quad countries. So as we saw before, it is only for open, inclusive, rule-based order. At the same time, they are respecting the international agreement, and there is no military angle to this kind of grouping. So if you see about the Quad countries, it was initially formed in the year 2007, and was quickly abandoned, and again in the year 2017 it got revived. And apart from all these, the US has been conducting freedom of navigation operations in the South China Sea region, which is mostly climbed by the China. The most of the parts of South China Sea is climbed by China, but now US has been conducting this freedom of navigation operations along with other countries in the South China Sea. And India also, from its part, the Indian Navy is also recently inaugurated the Indian Fusion Center in the Indian Ocean region, where the friendly countries in that region will have liaison officers for information sharing among the countries who are making use of the Indian Ocean region. So the next article is tokenization may aid safe digital transactions. So what the news here is, the RBI has recently taken a decision to allow the card payment providers to offer the tokenization services. So why this tokenization means, in order to ensure the safety of digital transactions and reduces the chances of the fraud during the online transactions. So first we have to understand what this tokenization means. So it is a process in which unique token mask sensitive card details like the card number, account number and CVV number, etc. So tokenization simply means substituting a sensitive data element with a non-sensitive equivalent. So this non-sensitive equivalent is known as the token, and it has no extrinsic or exploitable meaning or value. It has no meaning attached to it at all. So it is an identifier simply, which maps to the sensitive data through a tokenization system, and it will ensure secure and frictionless payment experience. So where we can make use of this tokenization means at the point of sales terminals and the QR code payments. So what are the main advantages of this tokenization means? It is mainly to enhance the payment security and safety to the next level by actually devaluing the data and replacing the payment credentials with the tokens which are generated. And this may further increase the credibility of the customers, and thereby it increases the digital transactions in India. So if you see some kind of data, the global mobile payments alone are expected to top nearly $3.3 trillion by 2024. And the compound annual growth rate of 60% between the year 2018 to 2024. So because of this huge amount of global mobile payment increase rate, which is put forward by the Zeon Market Research, we can actually include this kind of tokenization mechanism in order to increase the digital transaction and in order to get the credibility of the consumers. So how this tokenization works means, for example, consider a customer wants to buy something online. So he or she can enter her details, that is the card details or the CVV number, etc., into the online transaction. So here the credit card details which are put by the customers are sent to the intermediate app or the payment providers. So in this case, for example, consider Braintree's vault. So what they are going to do is, they, without ever hitting the merchant server, they securely saves the card details in their own vault and return simply a token to the merchant. So now the merchant is making use of that token for this or as well as any kind of future transactions without actually saving the credential or the credit card data of the users. So it further protects the user payment credentials. So this is how it works. So it is simply replacing the credit and debit card account numbers with the string of characters, which are digital tokens. Okay. So a new token can be created for each and every transaction, and only the banks would know the consumer's real account information. So the next article is NCDC model for cooperatives as modern banking unit. So what the news here is, the National Cooperative Development Corporation has launched a model for the cooperatives in order to strengthen the cooperative banks at various levels. Thereby, it can bring about the financial inclusion of the farmers in the remote villages of the country. So how they are going to achieve it means, by means of making the cooperatives to act as a modern banking unit. So what is this modern banking unit in the sense? So they are going to make the primary agricultural credit cooperative societies computerization project in order to provide a robust IT platform, which is leading to the automation of all the activities in the primary agricultural credit cooperative societies. They are making everything digitized. Okay, so this is what they mentioned as modern banking unit. So for that, they are going to facilitate the human resource development in the cooperatives by means of National Council for Cooperative Training Program. So here there is no minimum or maximum limit for the financial assistance under this NCDC model. And they're also going to take some comprehensive step for strengthening the cooperatives to act as a modern banking unit. And this new model of NCDC includes the upgradation and the new setup of IT and related infrastructure such as data centers, enterprise network, security and core banking solutions, ATMs, point of sales, e-lobby, etc. So all these kind of IT infrastructure is going to done under this NCDC model. Okay. So now we are going to see what are these activities of this primary agricultural credit cooperative societies. So they usually provide short-term loans to the members of PACS as well as it accept the deposits. So it lend as well as it receives the deposits, and it also can run PDS shops and it sell agricultural inputs and running the Janta Bazaar. So the next article is Ganga Jal project. So what the news here is, the Prime Minister dedicated to the nation this Ganga Jal project, which will provide Agra with better and more assured water supply. So this article especially talks about the initiatives taken by the government in order to conserve the region surrounding Agra as well as in order to make Agra a tourist friendly environment. So as per this, the first one is, which is the Ganga Jal, which aims to provide the Agra with assured water supply of 140 cusecs of water to Agra in order to meet the drinking water demands which is prevalent in the city. And the second major thing is the sewerage network project, which is taken under the Amrut scheme, especially in the western part of Agra, in order to improve the sanitation facility in Agra region. And the third major initiative by the government is integrated command and control center for Agra Smart City Mission in order to make Agra a tourist friendly smart city by means of installation of CCTV cameras throughout the city for monitoring as well as for the surveillance of the city for the purpose of safety and security. So these are the few initiatives taken by the government in order to boost the tourism sector in the Agra region. So the next article is private consumption, a 6 trillion opportunity. So the recent World Economic Forum study states that the domestic private consumption, which accounts for major portion of our country's GDP, is expected to develop into a 6 trillion growth opportunity. And if suppose it happens, it would make India the world's third largest economy by 2030, which is now in the position of 6th. So how World Economic Forum predicted this future of consumption in India means because of two major reasons. One is the broad-based pattern of growth, that is our growth, that is our economy's growth is consistently increasing and the benefit sharing is also increasing. So because of these two things, there might be a possibility of rising in income of the people. So due to all these reasons, the future of domestic private consumption in India in 2030 can get raised. So what the major thing here is, we can only achieve this 6 trillion opportunity only if we tap the potential by means of efficient business and policy making. So it should be done only by the business and the policy makers to make or to pursue an inclusive approach towards the economic and consumption growth. So how the business and the policy makers can make an inclusive approach means by means of addressing the critical societal issues, including we have to give proper skill development to the people. We have to give proper employment for the future workforce, and we have to make the socio-economic inclusion of the rural India to its entirety. As of now, the country faces a huge challenge in providing the existing workforce with the right skills. So there is a huge gap. So we have to first bridge that gap. So India also have to make socio-economic inclusion of especially the rural India by 2030, because the rural areas are where there are a lot of access barriers. So we have to break that barriers and we have to address the socio and economic inclusion in especially in the rural areas. And the business and the policy makers will have to take the initiative on improving both the health and the livability of India's citizens by providing them a better healthcare, sustainable development, as well as we have to seek the solutions for the urban congestion. So here both the private as well as the public sector leaders will have to take the responsibility as well as shared accountability in order to make this kind of consumption or the private consumption inclusive as well as a responsible one. So the next article is World Bank pegs India's GDP growth at 7.3% in 2018-19. So we all knew that India stands at 6th position or 6th largest economy in the world in terms of nominal GDP. And India stands third largest in terms of PPP, which is the purchasing power parity. So Also, apart from that, India's GDP growth is seeing a trend of 6.6, 7.2, 7.9 and 7.1 for the year 2017-18. So it is for 16-17. So we are increasing somewhat, but now actually they predicted that there is a further increase of 7.3% for the year 2018-19. So how the World Bank have actually forecasted this means, because we can attribute this GDP growth to two major things. One is there is an increase in consumption behavior, and second one is there is an increase in investment also. So both the consumption and the investment has actually grown. So how the consumption is growing means, because the domestic demand of the people has actually strengthened us because of the benefits of two major structural reforms. One is the GST and second one is the bank recapitalization. So because of these two things, the domestic demand has actually strengthened. Apart from domestic demand, the private consumption is also projected to remain robust. And apart from all these, the investment is also growing because of the benefits of the recent policy reforms by the government, like Invest India, Startup India, Stand Up India, etc. So because of all these recent policy reforms, the investment is also growing. And because of the structural reforms, the consumption pattern is also growing. So because of these both things, the GDP is also expected to grow at 7.3%. We can maintain the inflation above the midpoint of RBI's target, which is of range 2 to 6%, if we able to maintain both the energy and the food prices a stable one. So because these two are more volatile in nature, so if we are able to maintain this thing, then we can easily maintain the inflation target within the range of 2 to 6%. So the last article is Green Highways takes hit as saplings disappear. So what the news here is, the Union Minister of Road Transport has actually launched the Green Highways Plantation, Transplantation, Beautification and Maintenance Policy of 2015 in the year 2015. So he announced, as per the policy, nearly 1% of the total cost of any highway project should be earmarked or dedicated completely for this kind of plantation funds. Okay, so by means of this, nearly 1,000 crore would be made available under this green highway scheme, especially for the plantation along the highways. But what the news here is, the green highways project is not going as expected, and it is lagging with only 37% of the target of planting the trees along the highways is being achieved. So only 37% is achieved as of now, because the target is like 24 lakh plants, but only 9 lakh plants have been planted so far. So now we are going to see certain features of this green highways policy of 2015. So one is delinking of the plantation work from civil contract. So the first one is delinking of the plantation work from civil contract. That means whoever doing the highway project, they have to now do this plantation work also. And the second one is creation of the green corridors. And third one is environment improvement. And fourth one is employment opportunities. And the fifth one is enhanced highways aesthetics, and as well as tangible outcomes to the local people, and boost to entrepreneurship. And finally, 1% of the total project marked for plantation fund.